Good Sunday morning once again. I pray last Sunday, Communion Sunday, you enjoyed the sermon. God spoke to me in a very sensitive way and personal way. And that's what God does through sermon to each of us in our different avenues of life. Once again, our sister Althea Battle continues to be on vacation. Althea, we miss you, my sister in Christ. I pray all is well with you and your son Jordan, my nephew Jordan, my spiritual nephew. I hope that as we begin read scripture and have prayer, that God utilizes this part two to speak to you right where you are. If you enjoy the sermons, I invite you to share with your friends. We get comments from all over the country, from almost so many different states. I won't say almost every state, but a lot of different states. And share with your friends and your families that they may be blessed by God's word as I am and Taylor's congregation is. Put on that spiritual seatbelt because God is about to take us for a ride this morning. Amen.
Yeah. Oh, come on and praise him tonight. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. We bless your name. Oh, glory to God.
Part two of this sermon from the Gospel of John, chapter 9, verses 1 through 7, remains, is God, it's a question, is God glorified in you? Like I asked that same question for my life, is God glorified in me? Please, let's listen to the scripture. Now, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. That the works of God should be revealed in us. Jesus says, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is still day. The night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said these things, Jesus spat on the ground and made clay with his saliva. And he anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay. And he said to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. The man went and washed and came back seeing. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. Amen. Please humble ourselves. Let's humble ourselves for prayer. Oh God, let us be patient in our relationship with you. Let us not come as maybe a spoiled baby and demanding that this be done right now at this moment, but instead, even in the process, no matter how elongated it may seem, that we have patience, knowing that you are our God. No matter what the situation, you art with us, and you'll never leave, you'll never forsake us, and you will always be present. In the sense that we can feel you, we can sense you, and we know that if we can just quiet ourselves and meditate and listen to you, we will hear that voice of the Holy Spirit guiding us. We praise you for the guidance, and we praise you for the love, and we praise you for the grace. In your name, risen Savior, Jesus Christ, amen. In all of our lives, and all of our lives, there are places that may seem dark. There are situations that seem so overwhelming. We don't know if we're going to get out. As I preached last week about God metaphorically waving his hand, saying that all things work to the good. When I was saying that, I was letting you know that Jesus was stepping in to this place of this man's darkness, and Jesus was coming to meet him. And why do you think God said then that I am the light of the world? That I am. Jesus is the I am. Jesus is the I am of all of our lives. I am with you even when it's dark. I am with you no matter what your situation. I am never going to leave you. I am never going to forsake you. I don't care what your situation. God is the I am. Not that I may be, not that I might be, not that I was, but I won't be anymore. Jesus is the forever, from the beginning throughout eternity, the I am. Despite what the CPA said, Despite what the doctor said, despite what the psychologist says, Jesus is the I am. Despite what your friends say, regardless of what people are throwing at towards your back, Jesus is still the I am. Because if Jesus, you want to know if Jesus is the I am? Are you listening to this sermon? Jesus is the I am that has brought you this far by his grace. We have to understand that Jesus stepped into this place with this man. But in this man's darkness, Jesus did something that some in their exegesis might not understand. I don't want to use the fancy word. Exegesis. Let me go with eisegesis first. Eisegesis is a Greek word, and what it has to mean is that when we come and we open up our Bibles and we begin to read our Bibles, it's what we bring to the Bible. It's our experiences. It's our challenges. It's our upbringing. It's our parents. It's our environment. Those things create a place in our lives when we open up the Word of God. It could be two identical twins, but they come with different understandings and different interpretations of what the Word is. And then exegesis. Eisegesis is what you bring. Exegesis is what you take away. Again, it could be three identical triplets, and they've been in the same house, they've had the same parents, and they've been in the same environment, and yet when they read scripture, they're going to take three different things away from them. In the exegesis, for the lack of maybe not being exegetical proper and about what you take away from scripture, Jesus did something unorthodox. Jesus did something unorthodox. Jesus went to the man and Jesus did this. He spit on the ground. And when Jesus spit on the ground, he took his spit and he mixed it with dirt. Ooh, he mixed it with where the man and you and I come from. He mixed it with dirt and put it together. Jesus arose and put it on the man's eyes. Oh, Jesus did something that unorthodox. Never seen in the Old Testament. Never seen anywhere else in the New Testament. But Jesus did something unorthodox. Do people sometimes put down pastors because they feel they're doing something unorthodox? You know, let me share with you that it is time for our churches to step out of the rigidity of the way that we do churches. See, it's time to be unorthodox. It's time to follow the unorthodoxy of Jesus Christ. We are used to having templates of what church should be, the way church should happen. This is what we've always done. This is what we will continue to do. It may have worked for your grandparents. It may have worked for your great-grandparents. But I can guarantee you this, that your great-great-grandparents were doing church differently than their great-great-grandparents. It is time for us to start to look and to do church differently than the way that we have been doing it for decades upon decades. Yes, there's a pandemic upon this United States of America and the world. But it's time not to let go of God. It's just time that us to hold on to the unchanging hand of God to start to do church in a different way. God is opening up new ways of doing church. He is teaching us new ideas. We can't continue to do the bake sales we were doing in the 40s and 50s. The bake sales don't work anymore. We got bakeries that's around in every corner and they'll be producing the baked goods. It's time for us to become spiritually innovative. It's time for us to stop saying, who can come to God and who can't come to God. Only one that's got control over that is God himself. It's time to leave the judging and the sifting of who's who and what this person should do and what that person should do, and throw it out the window and look up to the heavens and say, Father, what would thou have me to do? What do you want me to do today in church? What are you telling to me? What are you speaking to me? Yes. Some of us say, I go to a conservative church. I like things to be nice and quiet, and that's okay. But some people want it a different way. Huh. Pastor, give me something in the scripture that says that. Why did Jesus choose 12 disciples of different environments, of different characters, and different gifts? Churches are going to be different. See, the only one that we should be following consistently is God. But if Jesus was unorthodox, we should be unorthodox, and we should be bringing our different gifts, making up this spiritual gumbo. You know, you got to have the roux. Oh, let me use metaphors. The roux is the foundation. I'm talking to somebody that may not understand what gumbo in New Orleans in the South is about. The roux has to be there, because that's the foundation. But more times than not, two houses next door to each other in New Orleans that making gumbo are going to use different ingredients. God gives us different churches where we can go, the things that we can attach ourselves to, because those ingredients match our spiritual taste. I'm not putting down any church. I'm not putting down any ministry. I am saying, though, God, Jesus Christ, in this scripture was showing us that he does things in unorthodox ways. Get ready, put on your seatbelt and lock it tight, and get ready to go for a spiritual ride that you've never been on. God is leading you into the newness of life. God is taking you to places that you haven't been before. Ha, ha, ha. You need to call somebody on the telephone. You need to run into the next room and say, the I am is leading me. I've got some dark areas in my life that I'm wrestling with. Ha, ha. But the light of the world is with me. The light of the world is in me. And I am going to continue to follow what God is saying. Now, some of y'all ain't gonna like this. Some of y'all, oh no, he's too radical. I serve a radical God. My God, Jesus Christ is radical. When he came, the Pharisees and the Sadducees did not like him because he was radical. I'm running after Jesus. I'm running after the one that is radical. I'm radical because my God is radical. Are you ready to be radical for God? Are you ready to stop judging others and start looking at yourself only? Are you ready to close your mouth and stop the gossip and say, what is God saying to you about you? Go to the mirror and start with the person in the mirror. I'm starting with the person in the mirror. I'm asking me to change my ways. I pray you are too. I want to close with this. That after Jesus finished being radical, Jesus took the clay, took the dirt and the saliva and mashed it, and he put it on the blind man's eyes. I don't know if you've ever heard this, but God gave it to me and I had never heard it, never read it. God, this man is blind, and you're going to take some mud and put it over his eyes? If he had any sight, it's even darker. Had you thought about that? But Jesus had just told him that I am the light of the world. The scripture says that Jesus took it, put it on his eyes, and he anointed him. Some of us have been anointed. That's listening to this sermon right now. And we were anointed a long time ago, and we still say, well, why this? What happened with that? And I don't like this. focus on your anointing. And the only way you can focus on your anointing is to focus on Jesus Christ. When Jesus anointed this blind man's eyes, Jesus told the man to go and wash in Siloam. He told him to go. But wait a minute. Jesus didn't say, hold my hand and follow me. Jesus says, go. Why? Scripture says that Jesus could make the crooked path straight. Oh, what are you going through? What are you going through? But it required something of the man. It required patience. Some of us have anointing, and God has anointed us, and it just hasn't come to fruition. That's why last week when I did the sermon, I did the prayer, I said, we pray for patience. We need patience. We have to stop thinking, this person did it, so it's my turn. That person did it, so I want to do it. Let's just be patient, because once the man found out he was sent, Siloam, sent. Once he found out he was sent, the man went. Woo! Once the man was sent, the man went, because God did the sending. Once the man got there, his sight came to bear, and then he came back. I want you to know something. God, whoever's listening to this, God has already spoken over your lives. He has already anointed your lives. The only thing is required is that maybe you stop looking at other folks and what they're doing and just put a tunnel vision on God. What art you saying to me, God? What art you saying to me about my life? Because when you start judging or gossiping about somebody else, Jesus is not in that. This has been a good sermon to me, for me. I want us to recognize that sometimes it's a process. Things do not always happen instantaneously. It was a process for Joseph in the well. He was anointed when his family threw him down in it. Sometimes families sadly do that. He was anointed when he went to the Potiphar's house and was accused of a lie. Ooh, gossip, lie, ooh. He was anointed when he was in prison. Oh, wait a minute. Job was anointed when all his cattle was destroyed. Job was anointed. God had told it to Satan, this is my servant in whom I'm well pleased. Job was anointed when all of his property was destroyed. Job was anointed when he lost all his family. People were coming to him and saying, just curse God and die. Woo, how sinful. But he refused. His life seemed dark. But Joseph, even in his darkness, said in Job 42, verse 5, my ears have heard of you, but now my eyes, they see you. Do your eyes see Jesus? Do you understand that he does things in unorthodox ways? Do you understand we cannot do church by the same, ways, the same templates that we used to use? God is evolving our theology. He's breeding us into a new understanding of all that God is. And it just requires surrender and patience and faith. Amen. God is telling us multiple things in this group of scriptures, as well in these two sermons. He is telling us to have faith in God. He is cautioning us about gossip, about talking about members in your church or members in your family, Because if you'll gossip about one thing, you'll gossip about everything. He's telling us about talking about the ushers, the finance committee, the trustees. He's telling us about talking about whoever your pastor is. What does it benefit you? Have you stopped to look and see, when we stop and look in the mirror, we see all the work that we've got to do on ourselves. So when somebody brings you gossip, just share with them. Don't put them down. Just tell them that you're not a part of that. You're starting with the person in the mirror, asking them to change their ways. Maybe they'll get the hint and go look in the mirror and see what God sees. God is also teaching us in this, is that whatever challenges we're going through, we have to have patience, that you are God's, and no matter what you're going through in life, all things work to the good. And it's like giving a baby or a child some medicine, and they're like, I don't want it. But the medicine is going to heal them. It's going to prepare them to be healthier later on. Sometimes we have to take the medicine God is giving us. We have to remember that. But I want to close with this. Start looking at church different. Don't go and say, oh, they need to have a Bible study or they need to do that. You go to God and ask God to have you start a Bible study. Go get your pastor's approval and then you start a Bible study. Pastors are stretched during these pandemic times. They're stretched, all of us. Our superintendent is stretched, our bishop is stretched. I'll let you in on a secret. They don't show it, but I'm sure, because we're creation. The only God is the creator. And I'm so blessed to have the bishop we have, the superintendent we have. But we have to start to look at church differently. We have to start thinking not outside the box, not just outside the box, but away from the box. Toss the box completely out of it and see what framework God is creating to take the church to the new level. Because whenever God decides, or wherever God introduces us to the decision of where He's decided to end this pandemic, church will never be like it was. God has called us to do a new thing. So let's start to think outside the box and let's see what we can do instead of saying what someone else can do. And bring that to your pastor and to your church and see how God blesses it. Have a great week. Pray for me, because I'm always praying for you.